entire service is in your bulletin, except for the opening hymn, which we will be singing in a moment. But everything else is within your bulletin. Also, for the confession, I will be using a different words of absolution than what you have printed at the bottom of page 2. So, at this time, I ask that you turn to page 2 in your bulletin, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and in deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors and ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with Jesus Christ Is Risen Today, hymn number 365 in the back of your red worship book. Hymn number 365.
Happy Easter. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. His first hymn is the text is written by Charles Wesley. And he wrote the fourth verse. It's a Welsh melody. It's an ancient 14th century Latin carol. Charles Wesley wrote the fourth verse. He's a noted Methodist minister, Charles Wesley. Latin carol, Jesus Christ Is Risen Today.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Allowed him to appear not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Before we sing the song, at this time, the young people in the congregation would like to go to Children's Church. If you would join Miss Nancy at the front of the sanctuary, I can follow her to Children's Church. Now we will sing. He is not here, for he hath been raised as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you. So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, greetings. And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see the gospel of our Lord. Right.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Two quick announcements. First of all, there will be no Wednesday church this Wednesday. So those of you who regularly show up on Wednesday, you have this Wednesday free. So there will be no service this Wednesday. And the other announcement is, I have spoken with the Chambers people, and the drive-in will be open this Sunday. In fact, when I talked to Mark Booth, they were already trying to get rid of all those big tall weeds that we had to drive through and dodge last year. So Memorial Day to Labor Day, the 8 o'clock service will be at the drive-in again as past 1 year. Now, may you give your attention to the choir.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I have been told that there is a certain Christian tribe in sub-Saharan Africa that when a member of the tribe passes away, that they gather not for a funeral, but for a celebration. That once the service starts, it begins with joyous music and hand clapping, and as the service continues, you hear shouts of, "He's gone home," or "She's gone home," depending on whether it's male or female. Or if there are a couple of people being buried that day, "They've gone home, they've gone home." These shouts fill the air, and they dance to the cemetery, still clapping their hands and playing joyous music and making that proclamation that the loved one has gone home. Well, it seems like these brothers and sisters in Christ in sub-Saharan Africa have understood the resurrection message, and not only understood it, but incorporated it in their daily life as they are able to look at dying as going home. Not a separation, not as the end of everything, but simply going home. On that first Easter morning, Christ burst the bonds of death and assured us the victory over death as well. Such news can indeed elicit such a response of a dead one as those by our African brothers and sisters. "They've gone home, they've gone home. Hallelujah, Jesus, they've gone home." On that first Easter morning, at dawn, we read that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, some others, were going to the tomb. You're familiar with the story. Jesus dying on Good Friday. It was close to sundown, which was going to begin the Passover and the Sabbath. So the bodies had to be buried before sundown came. So all the spices and all the ritual of Jewish burial was not able to be carried out on that Friday. So now the women are coming to finish what should have been done. And as they come near the tomb, there is a sudden earthquake as an angel from heaven comes down from heaven and rolls the stone away. The guards, so afraid, faint and lie on the ground like dead men. And the angel tells the women not to fear, that they are looking for he who was crucified. But he says to them, "He is not here, for he has risen." He is not here, for he has risen. The message of the angel again breaks into our modern world, even into the darkness of a topsy-turvy world that some days we wonder if it has been completely out of control. When we read the newspaper or watch the news and read of another horrible killing, someone told me after the 8 o'clock service that somewhere down in Florida, a man went into a barbershop, demanded a haircut for $2, and the barber said he wouldn't give him a haircut for $2. And, you know, barbers hadn't charged $2 for haircuts since back in the 50s or 60s. He got pulled out of him and shot him because he wouldn't give him a $2 haircut. When we read things like that, we wonder if life is gone. We wonder if everything has gone out of control. But that message that he is not here, for he is risen, tells us that life is still worth living. Life is still worth living because it has meaning. This is why every life is important. This is why every life matters. God has a purpose and a meaning for every life that he creates. And when that life is cut short by some heinous act of violence, or some terrorist act, or by some type of accident that could have been avoided, When such a life is cut short, we never know if that person may have been the one to give us a new cure for an incurable disease, may have been the one to give us a new invention to make our lives easier, may have been the one to develop a new way of learning to challenge our young people who, from a very early age, get hooked on video games and tablets and iPads and all these things, so that sitting in a classroom hearing a teacher lecture just doesn't always cut it anymore. For our children, or I should say grandchildren. And so maybe that person would have developed this new learning, incorporating the communication with the learning that needs to be known. Or that might have been the next great musician, the next great Bach, Beethoven, the next great poet, the next great writer. But we will not know because our life was short. Each life is blessed by God for a purpose. And if we listen to God and follow God, then He blesses us in that direction He wants us to go as we follow Him. But if we turn our back on God, and if we turn our back on the laws and morals of society, if we think we can do what we want to do just because it's a whim, then God just as very easily can take away that blessing on that life, and it becomes a life of crime and degradation. The Easter message tells us that life does make sense. As St. Paul tells us in that famous 8th chapter of his letter to the Romans, that 28th verse, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose." End quote. We know that for those who love God, all things work for the good. Now, sometimes in the midst of a tragedy, that's hard to comprehend. Sometimes at a funeral, the graveside of a loved one, that is maybe hard to understand. But think about the different events of your life, positive and negative, and how something good came out of them, even the negative ones. If nothing else, you learn some type of lesson. And so life has meaning, and life is important. As the women approached the tomb, their minds were spinning with questions and with confusion, because it seemed like the world had been turned upside down. A thug named Barabbas had been freed instead of Jesus, the Messiah. With the crucifixion of Jesus, justice seemed to have been turned on its head as the guilty went free and the innocent were punished. With the empty tomb, all of that changed. Jesus' death makes sense, as the innocent must die for the guilty so that we all might, who believe, might have eternal life. So the good comes out of the bad. It was horrible that Jesus was crucified. It was horrible that a thug like Barabbas was set free. But in the end, it all worked out, because Jesus, by dying, is dead right, so that we might be raised. The message of the angel, "He is not here, for He is risen," shows us that life has ultimate worth. A worth not measured by earthly trinkets. A worth not measured by selfish standards of society. But life has worth in serving God. Life has worth in serving our neighbor. Life has worth in being a little Christ unto her neighbor, so that the hungry person is fed, the naked person is clothed, the thirsty person is given a glass of water to drink, the sick are cared for, the widow, the orphan, and the stranger in our midst are greeted as a brother or sister in Christ. not here, for he is risen. The message that Jesus is risen and alive tells us also that the future can be faced. The future can be faced because God knows the future. The future can be faced because we know that God has already won the victory through His Son, Jesus Christ. The Easter message assures us that we who believe in His Son, that no matter what might afflict us in this earthly world, God has got ultimate victory won for us that first Good Friday on that hill called Calvary, and on that third day, raising Jesus from the dead. And that ultimate victory is shared with us by granting us eternal life. Through His Son, Jesus Christ, God is always with us, walking beside us, walking with us, and when facing those difficult times in life, picking us up and carrying us until we are strong enough to walk on our own, side by side with Him again. The Easter message that Jesus is risen and alive assures us that death can be handled. Life's most difficult subject is death. Since the beginning of time, since our first parents were cast out of the Garden of Eden, and death came into the world, every civilization, every community, every village, every ethnic group, every race, every culture has tried to figure out death. How do you handle death? What do you do about death? How do you cope with death? As Christians, we handle it with faith, like our African brothers and sisters, knowing that our loved one has gone home. Gone back to where we always were meant to be, in the presence of Almighty God, our Father, and our Creator. Remember, when God first created our first parents and placed them in the garden, they could walk with God, and they could talk with God face to face. And they had this wonderful relationship with God. But then they had to give in to temptation and brought sin into the world. And that closeness and that intimacy with God was evil. But because Jesus Christ died upon that cross that first Good Friday, because on that first day of the week He rose from the dead, we now have that relationship restored, and when we leave this pilgrimage on earth, we are reunited with our Heavenly Father and His kingdom, where we can walk down the streets of the New Jerusalem with Him, where we can be in His presence and not be afraid. It is said that when Winston Churchill was planning his funeral, which was to take place in St. Paul's Cathedral, that he wanted a bugler placed in the dome, on one side of the dome. And as the funeral liturgy ended and they prepared to take Churchill's body down the aisle and out of the church, that bugler was to play taps. And then when Churchill's body got to the end of the aisle and they were about to leave the sanctuary, go through the narthex and down the stairs, carrying Sir Winston to the cemetery, there was to be a bugler on the other side of the dome. And that bugler was to play Reveille. This was Winston Churchill's last act of witness to his Christian faith. Taps, we go to sleep. Reveille, we wake up. The universal call to the military person to sleep with taps, rise up to the reveille, the same with our life. We're put to sleep on this earth, but then we ride to that heavenly kingdom. We can handle death because Jesus handled it for us and laid out for us the path for our going home. In the Apostles' letter to the Hebrews, in the 12th chapter, verses 1 and 2, the Apostle writes a very interesting image for those of us who proclaim Jesus as Lord. He writes, quote, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." What is the apostle saying? The imagery is out of a coliseum, athletic coliseum, filled to overflowing for a track. The great cloud of witnesses are those who go before us in the faith. Not just the giants of our faith, but our grandparents and great-grandparents, our parents, brother or sister, or even a child. It's anyone who believed in Jesus Christ. They fill up the Colosseum to encourage us as we are the athletes down on the track competing in the events as we compete in life. And so they are there encouraging us. And they are telling, and the writer is telling us how we are to cast aside sin and the weight that clings to us. This is the imagery of the athlete getting in shape, jumping rope and running and lifting, doing all those things to get his body as well toned as possible. That's why I wanted to be a boxer, even though Muhammad Ali grew up in my hometown, and I got to meet him a couple of days after he beat Sonny Liston to become heavyweight champion. He flew into Louisville for a hometown reception, but I never wanted to be a boxer because he always had to. You'd have to get in training and fight, and then you wouldn't fight for a couple of months and get out of shape, and you'd have to get back in shape again when you were going to fight. Well, here the apostle's telling us, don't let the things of life cling to us and slow us down in our race of life. And then he tells us the key to running our race. And that key is when he says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. The word looking, it means to focus on the finish line. It means to zero in on something. It means to have what we would say today, like a laser-like vision, just on that one spot. A good runner will not look back when they're running. They focus on the finish line, because the look back slows you down. If you have a moderate interest in horse racing, but aren't all that familiar with the workings of a race and the track, you'll see, like in a race, all the horses have this colored thing over their faces. Some of them have these little cup-like things. Well, those are called blinkers or blinds, and they're put on race horses who can't race without looking left or right. They get distracted. They want to see who's coming up on the side there, or who's on this side. That slows them down. So a horse like that, you put the blinkers on them, or blinders. And that way they focus, all they can see is straight ahead. They can't see who's coming up here. This is the imagery that the apostle is saying to us. We have our blinders on. We run our race of life looking to Jesus. Why? Because he is the founder and perfecter of our faith. The word founder means trailblazer. Jesus has laid the trail to that dwelling place he's preparing for us. Jesus has blazed the trail to that mansion that he prepares for us. Jesus has blazed the trail to that far side bank of Jordan. Jesus has blazed the trail to that land that is fairer than day, which by faith we see from afar. Jesus has blazed the trail to that great getting up moment when all the graves will open and the world will see that Jesus is indeed King. But he's also the founder of our faith and trust. That word means to reach a goal or to complete something. It is the root word of the sixth word that Jesus said on the cross. And he said, it is finished. Tetelestai. This is a form of that. That word means to finish something, to complete it, to reach a goal. Jesus said it from the cross because he had done all that his Father had asked. He had won for us salvation through the giving of his blood on the cross. So Jesus now is the one who completed our faith, completed the act of salvation. So we look to him as we continue to run that race. So we focus on him, we lock on him, and he leads us to eternal life. That shows us that we can handle death because we know the end. We know how the story ends. Not in that graveside, not in that urn filled with ashes. The story ends in that dwelling place Jesus is preparing for us as we live. There was an avid golfer who one day went to an astrologer and asked her if there were golf courses in heaven. So the astrologer got down her charts and her maps and all that astrologers use, and she looked at all these charts and whatever. And she said to the guy, looked up at the golfer, and she says, I have good news and I have bad news. The golfer said, well, give me the good news. She said, there are golf courses in heaven. And not only are there golf courses in heaven, but the greens are perfect, the fairways are beautiful. It makes the Augusta where the Masters is played look like a playground. And the golfer, of course, was all excited about that. Wonderful, these golf courses will be in heaven. He goes, all right, now you might as well give me the bad news. She says, you have a tea time at 8:30 next Thursday morning. So the golfer was happy, but it was also sad. At the grave of a loved one, we are saddened by the departure. But we are also happy because, like our African brothers and sisters, we know they've gone home. We know they've gone to that greatest homecoming in heaven. We know that this is true because of that Easter message. He is not here. For he is risen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
For those who can without the coffee, please stand and confess our faith.
Who has spoken.
Our response today is, hear our prayer. Gracious God, as we celebrate new life and the resurrection, make your church courageous in its witness and bold in its proclamation so that those who live in the shadow of death may see the light of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Proclaimer of justice, grant local and national leaders wisdom to govern with humility and grace, ensuring the security and dignity of all people in their care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all solace, you comforted Mary Magdalene at the tomb by making known to her the risen Christ. Comfort all who grieve and who are ill, that they may know the peace of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Faithful God, you call us to new life in the resurrection of your Son. Grant all the baptized grace to walk forth as your faithful people and be bold witnesses in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Eternal source of peace, as you raised your Son on the third day, so raise us on the last day to live in glory of Christ with you and all the saints for whom we praise you today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With heaven and earth and all creation, we offer our prayers in the name of the one who gave us eternal life and joy, your risen Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
It's time for our offering today. It's Easter Sunday, April 16, 2017. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. We remember on Good Friday when Jesus said, "Into your hands I commend my spirit." Jesus' soul left his body. And this is how Jesus has gone before us. He has risen from the dead. His resurrected body, we can see that above our altar. He's prophet, priest, and king. He bears the crown of king. He wears the stole of prophet and priest. He's prophet, priest, and king. He's risen indeed. We invite you to come and receive his body and blood as he has left this for us, so he'll always be with us, truly body, true body and true blood. We see that today, the gift of eternal life. He is risen indeed. We rise with him, resurrected body. His tomb is empty. This is Easter Sunday, April 16th, 2016. Our services at St. John's Lutheran Church are at 8 o'clock every Sunday and at 10:30 every Sunday. Sunday school is 9:15. We invite you to come and worship with us. Jesus is with us. You can receive eternal life and you receive Jesus with you every minute as he will be able to feed us to his risen indeed, and we will rise with him. Our souls go to be with God when we die, just as Jesus gave his spirit up on the cross.
Invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 7 in your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
The true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and seas and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
can, please stand. Light of the Lord Jesus Christ, and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve your true faith unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with "Because He Lives" on the back, printed on the back of your worship book.
Our final hymn was written by William J. Gaither, born in 1971, and is an American songwriter, wonderful piano player. This is "God Sent His Son Because He Lives." Jesus lives. And he gives us eternal life as we receive his precious body and blood today. And we've communed with those who've gone before us. We're all communing together. All those who've died and gone before us are looking down from heaven at us right now.
Grace.
bless you and thank you for watching this service on YouTube. Thank you for joining us for Easter. Because he lives, we can be not afraid. He holds the future. He has given himself for us, and he's with us every minute of every day. And we don't have to be afraid, just he says, be not afraid. He is with us every minute. He gives us his body and blood, his precious body and precious blood with us. He died on the cross to save us from sin. He yielded up his spirit to God at the time of death, and he has risen from the dead. The tomb is empty. Jesus came from the tomb in his resurrected body. We receive his wounds, hands, feet, side, five wounds that are given for us as he died for us, suffered for us, and he's our living sacrifice. He lives because he lives, and he holds the future. We invite you to come every Sunday, 8 o'clock or 10:30. Join us and receive eternal life through service of the Word and service of Sacrament of Holy Communion. We thank you for being with us Easter. Christ is alive, he's risen indeed.